All right, Derek, what is your official title here at Rahal Lanigan Racing?
Crew chief at Rahal Letterman Lanigan Racing, oversee most of the activities on the 30 and 15 car.
Well, first of all, I mean, Derek is, he's a gentleman, you know, he's a great man, he's a great family man, and I'm proud to be associated with him. When he came over here, when I drove for Dryan Reinbold for that race or two, you know, in 2010, I had met Derek, but I'd never spent much time with him. But when he came over here, he's just a great leader, you know, a great leader for our team. A guy who's kind of been through it all, a guy who had so much success. He will never really say this, but so much success in his own racing career, worked his way up to get a test in an IndyCar. I think people just respect Derek. I don't think, you know, he's just the type of guy you just won't hear any bad about.
Well, the reason we wanted to talk to you, my website's about getting to know the people behind the scenes in the sport. And I think people in general would think you're super cool for two reasons. First of all, you're probably the only guy in this paddock that works on these cars that's actually driven an IndyCar. Is that correct?
Actually, no. There's a few others. There's a spotter for Carpenter and then Simmons, I believe he drove one that works at Ganassi. So, no, but yeah, there's very few. There's only, you know, a handful of us that have done that. So, yeah, I've been pretty fortunate from that respect. And I have a lot of respect for these guys out here that do it and hang it out on the line every weekend. And that's why I appreciate what they do. You know, I do appreciate what these drivers have.
Does that give you any sort of better understanding of what they need when getting the car ready for them or anything like that? Does that give them an advantage, let's say?
I mean, mentally, I think I know what some of the things they're going through mentally as far as the aggravation and frustration and how to keep your head in it mentally and things like that. You know, try to keep the driver pumped up. I can see that kind of stuff being advantageous. But no, I mean, they're doing it on a whole different level than what I did it, you know, professionally. And they have a lot more demands as far as, you know, public relations commitments and things like that. Yeah. So it's, no, I'm not really completely aware of what they go through day to day, but I do know, you know, how aggravating it is to not get what you want out of the car or and things like that. So I do understand that side of it, but I think that's probably advantageous, just understanding the mental side of it.
You mentioned the PR demands, yet here you are doing an interview as we speak.
Yeah, I don't do as many as they do.
Yeah. Second reason, you are highly, highly respected within the paddock. As I've talked to different people about my project, three of them, I'll say a competition director, a PR person, and a competing crew chief, all said Derek Davidson is the guy I should talk to. How does that make you feel?
Actually, it makes me feel really good. I don't know who they would be.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll bug you and find out, because I'm curious too. But no, that does make me feel really good. You know, I mean, there's a lot of talent in this garage area working on cars and you know, setting them up, and just a lot of good people in this industry. And just to have a few from other teams say that, it does make me feel pretty good.
Yeah, that's very cool. Growing up, was there ever any sort of consideration as to like a fallback career if racing in general didn't work out? Did you see yourself being like an accountant or something like that?
Yeah, actually, I went to Purdue for advertising and you know, business management, and I thought that, you know, it was twofold, because I liked advertising, I liked watching ads on TV and being creative and stuff like that, so I thought that would be pretty cool. But it was also so I could try to land the big sponsor so I could drive in the Indianapolis 500, because that was my deal, right?
Yeah.
And I got close, but I didn't get to Indy.
Right.
And then the whole advertising side of it, the business side of it, I did that for a while.
Yeah.
And when I quit driving and I got, I guess, what you consider a real job for like a year, I missed this way too much. And I thought, you know, I got to get back into racing in some fashion. So I got back into the racing side of it, and I said, you know what, my next step, I'm just going to work my way up and try to get into some kind of management position. And Still live out my dream. I still want to win the Indy 500, and hopefully this year's the year. And then, I'm still living out my dream. I'm not going to do it as a driver, but hopefully I win that race before I die.
So when we first met, this was back in 2005 over at Panther Racing. Was that your kind of first step into the business after advertising?
Yeah, actually it was. I went I was out of it. I was, Saturdays and Sundays we were eating, barbecues with my family, and it was all fun, but I just missed something. There was something inside of me that missed being at the track and the competition and just the whole stress of it, really. I mean, it's kind of a different, it's kind of like a disease, honestly. It's like alcoholism or something like that. That's what racing does to me. But anyway, yeah, so I got back into it, and a friend of mine from the sprint car world, Davy Jones, got me a job over at Panther, and coincidentally, that just happened to be the team that I took the IndyCar test for, so yeah. I had a spot in my heart for that place anyway, and then, I went to work there, and I've been doing IndyCar racing ever since, and loved every minute of it.
You mentioned the bug. You were in racing, you worked a normal 9-to-5. There's a lot of people that try to leave the industry because you're working 7 days a week, 12, 13 hours a day. People think the grass is greener on the other side, but they always come back. I was out of it for 9 years and here I am. What is it about this that just keeps...
Well, the grass
back?
Is a different shade. It's still green. It's just a different shade, right? Like I say, it's like a disease. It's almost like a sickness because I don't know. I think it's the competition and it's the, it's just a cool industry. Cars are fast, I don't know. The Indianapolis 500 sitting there on race day on the grid with all these people there, even though they're not looking at you or whatever, but you're part of it. You are a big part of this race and history for that matter. And I don't know, it's really hard to describe, but every race day, I've been doing race day there for 15 years, and every time I drive under the tunnel, I get goosebumps. I'm almost getting goosebumps right now
talking about it
because the place is, it's just incredible. It's really hard to describe, but that's the way it is to me.
So despite being this busy crew chief, working the 13-hour days, you still have time to help your daughter start her racing career. Talk about that a little bit.
She wanted to race karts. I didn't take her seriously because the last thing I want to do is have my precious little girl racing a go-kart. But she proved me wrong. She saved up the money. She bought the first kart.
And good for
she,
her.
She told me, she goes, Dad, if I buy the kart, will you support me? And I said, seriously? I said, how'd you save up that much money to start with? She did. So she bought the kart, and I've supported her ever since.
Wow.
And it's been pretty good. No, it's fun. I have a lot of fun doing it with her.
Yeah.
Skid Marks, his daughter Michaela, races out there as well.
Yeah.
You're
so well-respected. People keep walking by.
Yeah, I see that.
To tease you as we're talking here.
Yeah.
Well, tell us more about your daughter. Name, age, website.
It's Ava Davidson. She's 17. She'll be 18 this May. We just got a new kart. She's running her second season. She's going to race out of Newcastle Motorsports Park in the KRA series. She's just now started getting sponsorship. She opened up a website. She did the whole web graph, design and all that stuff on herself. It's AvaDavidsonRacing.com.
Very cool.
And she's just trying to get sponsorship and do it for fun, mainly to see where it takes her.
Right.
It's only her second season, so we'll see where it goes. But right now she's having a lot of fun with it, and I have a lot of fun with it too.
Awesome.
Yeah, well, our performance shop, what we do is we work on highline vehicles. We've worked on a little bit of everything, but the focus is really highline vehicles, wheels, exhaust. We manufacture some exhaust for the new Acura NSX, manufacture exhaust for the Porsche 911 GT models, so GT3, GT3 RS, 911R, all those. But we do a lot of, a variety of stuff. And, of course, Derek, when he reached out to me to work with Ava, I've always kind of helped her in the background and stuff. And we decided to, I didn't even ask for any, exposure at all. I just wanted to help him. He's a guy that does a lot for me. Just to be able to give back to him and to his daughter helps.
Well, for a lot of reasons, you are just a super, super cool dude. I thank you for taking the time out to talk to us, and I wish you the best of luck, man.
All right. Thanks a lot, Kaveh. I appreciate
it. Much.